Can somebody shut the front door? Is it showing live? Good morning.
Good morning.
My name is Sean Hudgenwardle, and I will be your moderator for this morning's class. Welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school, and it is not a church. Neither are we affiliated with any religious organization. This school is a nonprofit, non-denominational, religious, and scientific research organization dedicated to showing proof of the existence of Yahweh, our Elohim, and the operation of his eternal purpose, pattern, and plan operating throughout eternity to this present day. This school was established as a result of a divine vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in 1931. We were incorporated in the state of California in 1958. Since then, we've established various branch schools throughout the United States and in various foreign countries. The Ontario branch was established in May of 1988. In this school, we use the true, correct, and original name and title for the Father, the Word or Son, and the Holy Spirit, as contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name of our Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title for the Word or Son is Elohim. It has been improperly substituted by God. The name of the Holy Spirit manifested in or out of a physical body is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted by Jesus Christ. Lord and God are titles, and they are not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8 and 5 that there are lords many and gods many, but we now know that each lord must have a name, and each god must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This means that Elohim is the title that our Creator chose for himself. Jesus is a name, but it is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part into a good dictionary or encyclopedia would prove that neither the Hebrew, the Greek, nor the Latin languages have any letters or characters in their alphabet that would produce the sound that is made by this letter J. Neither was there a letter J in the English language until some 1,400 years after the death of the Messiah. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings for the true and original name, for our Father and His Son. Christ is a title, just like Lord and God. Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state he is incomprehensible and inscrutable. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of all things. We have Yahweh symbolized on this chart as a cloud. Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize himself because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. We have this cloud drawn all around the edges of this chart to show you that everything on this chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Now, Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and form right within himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son. A super incorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without having flesh and blood. This form can only be seen in divine visions and understood in divine revelations. Later on, this selfsame spirit manifested himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world calls Jesus Christ. Now there is only one name given unto salvation, and we all must know this name. So the simple yet intelligent question that we should ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time that he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title may be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also in this school, we teach by the divine pattern of the universe. It is called the divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt, he instructed Moses to come atop of Mount Sinai, where he showed him a tabernacle pattern in a vision. He instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. This pattern consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court round about. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. We go forth in this school to show proof of that everything in the universe is made and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. The 10 primary constitutional aims and objectives of the Institute are as follows. First is to help you find and know Yahweh, our Elohim, as he really is and actually exists. Second is to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah without distinction of race, nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third is to investigate the unexplained spirit law or so-called law of nature and the powers latent in man. Fourth is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religion, psychology, philosophy, modern, practical, and occult science. Fifth is to extirpate current superstition, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth is to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensations and ages. Seventh is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan and his demons operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensations of time. Eighth is to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith which was once delivered to the sons or children of Yahweh. Ninth is to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained that there is no other name given among men whereby man can be saved, saving the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And tenth is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace. Our slogan is to speak the truth. Today, we will have a prayer by Dr. Samuel Salas. That will be followed by a selection of music. Our scripture lesson today will be Exodus, the 12th chapter, and that will be read by Todd Chinook. Dr. Salas.
Good morning. This is a time of prayer. It's about our heart and mind. Thank you, Almighty Yahweh. Give us a strong desire for learning your purpose and your plan. We are in a physical body. Sometimes we are weak. We need your spirit. Pour all your wisdom, knowledge, understanding of your purpose and plan of salvation. In this perilous time, we need that. Thank you. And I say all those things in your only son's name, Yahshua the Messiah. Let's all say hallelujah.
By the grace of Yah, praise Morning, class.
Morning. I'll be reading Exodus chapter 12 from the Holy Name Bible, critically compared with ancient authorities and various manuscripts, revised by A.B. Trena and the Scripture Research Association. And Yahweh spake unto Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, saying, This month shall be unto you the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year to you. Speak ye unto all the congregation of Israel, saying, In the tenth day of this month they shall take to them every man a lamb, according to the house of their fathers, a lamb for an house. And if the household be too little for the lamb, let him and his house take it according to the number of souls, every man according to his eating shall make your count for the lamb. Your lamb shall be without blemish, a male of the first year. Ye shall take it out from the sheep or from the goats, and ye shall keep it until the 14th day of the same month. And the whole assembly of the congregation of Israel shall kill it between the two evenings. And they shall take of the blood and strike it on the two side posts and on the upper door posts of the houses, wherein they shall eat it. And they shall eat the flesh in the night, roast with fire and unleavened bread, and with bitter herbs they shall eat it. Eat not of it raw, nor boiled at all with water, but roast with fire, his head with his legs, and with the inwards thereof. And ye shall let nothing of it remain until the morning, and that which remaineth of it until the morning ye shall burn with fire. And thus shall ye eat it, with your loins girded, your shoes on your feet, and your staff in your hand. And ye shall eat it in haste. It is Yahweh's Passover. For I will pass through the land of Egypt this night, and will smite all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, both man and beast, and against all the deities of Egypt I will execute judgment. I am Yahweh. And the blood shall be to you a token upon the houses where ye are. And when I see the blood, I will pass over you, and the plague shall not be upon you to destroy you, when I smite the land of Egypt. And this day shall be unto you for a memorial, and ye shall keep it a feast to Yahweh throughout your generations. Ye shall keep it a feast by an ordinance forever. 7 days shall ye eat unleavened bread. Even the first day ye shall put away leaven out of your houses. For whosoever eateth leavened bread from the first day until the seventh day, that soul shall be cut off from Israel. And in the first day there shall be an holy convocation, and in the seventh day there shall be an holy convocation to you. No manner of work shall be done in them, save that which every man must eat, that only may be done of you. And ye shall observe the feast of unleavened bread, for in this selfsame day have I brought your armies out of the land of Egypt. Therefore shall ye observe this day in your generations by an ordinance forever. In the first month, on the 14th day of the month at even, ye shall eat unleavened bread until the 21st day of the month at even. 7 days shall there be no leaven found in your houses, for whosoever eateth that which is leavened, even the soul shall be cut off from the congregation of Israel, whether he be a stranger or born in the land. Ye shall eat nothing leavened, in all your habitations shall ye eat unleavened bread. Then Moses called for the elders of Israel, and said unto them, Draw out, and take you a lamb, according to your families, and kill the Passover. And ye shall take a bunch of hyssop, and dip it in the blood that is in the basin, and strike the lintel and the two side posts with the blood that is in the basin. And none of you shall go out at the door of his house until the morning. For Yahweh will pass through to smite the Egyptians, and when he seeth the blood upon the lintel and on the two side posts, Yahweh will pass over the door, and will not suffer the destroyer to come in unto your houses to smite you. And ye shall observe this thing for an ordinance to thee and thy sons forever. And it shall come to pass, when ye be come to the land which Yahweh will give you, according as he hath promised, that ye shall keep this service. And it shall come to pass, when your children shall say unto you, What mean ye by this service? That ye shall say, It is the sacrifice of Yahweh's Passover, who passed over the houses of the children of Israel in Egypt, when he smote the Egyptians and delivered our houses. And the people bowed the head and worshipped. And the children of Israel went away, and did as Yahweh had commanded Moses and Aaron, so did they. And it came to pass that at midnight Yahweh smote all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, from the firstborn of Pharaoh that sat on his throne, unto the lastborn of the captive that was in the dungeon, and all the firstborn of cattle. And Pharaoh rose up in the night, he and all his servants and all the Egyptians. And there was a great cry in Egypt, for there was not a house where there was not one dead. And he called for Moses and Aaron by night, and said, Rise up, and get you forth from among my people, both ye and the children of Israel, and go, serve Yahweh, as ye have said. Also take your flocks and your herds, as ye have said, and be gone, and bless me also. And the Egyptians were urgent upon the people, that they might send them out of the land in haste. For they said, We be all dead men. And the people took their dough before it was leavened, their kneading troughs being bound up in their clothes upon their shoulders. And the children of Israel had done according to the words of Moses, and they had demanded of the Egyptians jewels and of silver, and jewels of gold, and raiment. And Yahweh had given the people favor in the sight of the Egyptians, so that they gave to them such things as they demanded, and they recovered from the Egyptians. And the children of Israel journeyed from Ramses to Succoth, about 600,000 on foot that were men besides children. And a mixed multitude went up also with them, and flocks and herds, even very much cattle. And they baked unleavened cakes of the dough which they brought forth out of Egypt, for it was not leavened, because they were thrust out of Egypt and could not tarry, neither had they prepared for themselves any victuals. Now the sojourning of the children of Israel who dwelt in Egypt was 430 years. And it came to pass at the end of the 430 years, even the selfsame day it came to pass, that all the hosts of Yahweh went out from the land of Egypt. It is night to be much observed. It is a night to be much observed unto Yahweh, for bringing them out from the land of Egypt. That is the night of Yahweh to be observed of all the children of Israel in their generations. And Yahweh said unto Moses and Aaron, This is the ordinance of the Passover. There shall no stranger eat thereof. But every man's servant that is bought for money, when thou hast circumcised him, then shall he eat thereof. A foreigner and a hired servant shall not eat thereof. In one house shall it be eaten. Thou shalt not carry forth aught of the flesh abroad out of the house, neither shall ye break a bone thereof. All the congregation of Israel shall keep it. And when a stranger shall sojourn with thee, and will keep the Passover to Yahweh, let all his males be circumcised, and then let him come near and keep it, and he shall be as one that is born in the land. For no uncircumcised person shall eat thereof. One law shall be to him that is homeborn, and unto the stranger that sojourneth among you. Thus did all the children of Israel, as Yahweh commanded Moses and Aaron, so did they. And it came to pass the selfsame day that Yahweh did bring the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt by their armies. I read Exodus, the 12th chapter. Let's all say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Dr. Samuel Salas, and thank you, Dr. Todd Chinook. Today we will have a two-speaker format. And for our first speaker for today's lecture, I would like to call Dr. Marlon Love.
Good morning, class.
Good morning.
How's everybody doing?
Delightful.
All right, that's good. Beautiful class even thus far this morning. Everything seems very crystal clear and enjoyed the song that was played. Hadn't heard that song but for a while. And enjoy the prayer that was given by Samuel, and the scripture reading was very well read. It's a long scripture, that 12th chapter of Exodus, but it says a lot about the Passover by which it was talking about, Yahweh's Passover, if you would, of the children of Israel coming from out of Egypt and into the wilderness or the holy place. And before one can get to the Passover, you have to get some information prior to coming to this 12th chapter of Exodus. Because if you read at the very beginning, it talks about this month shall be unto you the beginning of months. And right away, one would say, well, this is the start of something big, you know. And as you read on down through, it talks about, hey, Yahweh's going to deliver through Moses' direction to come up out of this Egypt. And it seems like it's a good thing. And even on April, even in our Gregorian calendar, a lot of people recognize April as this event in the in time, according to dispensations. Be the fourth dispensation by which this event is occurring that we read about there in the 12th chapter. And to this day, there's millions of people that recognizes this event. Now, this is a school and it's not a church. As the moderator clearly stated, this school came about by profound divine vision and revelation given to a man. And Yahweh has been working through a man all the way down through the ages and dispensations. And what I mean by that is Yahweh has been working with man, be it the first man, Adam. Through Adam, you have other patriarchs. We have another big story called Noah, of the events that transpired. Yahweh working through and with Noah in order for them to get into an ark. A particular ark. That was structured and required of Yahweh for Noah to build for 120 years. Yahweh working through a man, just like Yahweh gave Dr. Kinley a divine vision and revelation, he gave Noah a divine vision to build an ark in order for some souls, eight souls, to get into in order to preserve themselves from this horrific flood that Moses talked about for 120 years, and no man has seen rain fall from the sky. Moses, you're crazy. We'll help you build it because you might have their barter system work at that time. He had help other than his three sons, you know. For 120 years, he's building this ark and talking about this rain that's coming. Yahweh working through him. Now again, I just made the statement Yahweh told Noah to build an ark. And that has to be understood in order to make that statement. Because Noah didn't know the name of Yahweh. Noah didn't know he was talking to Yahweh at this time. Adam wasn't talking to Yahweh at that time. Or it being the name of Yahweh expressed to these patriarchs back here. And that's why it came this way, in order to express, we can't start specifically with this Passover event until we have some more information about why we got to this point. That's my preface. Because otherwise, you're reading about Lord. If you're not familiar with the names, number one, you're going to read that book or any other Bible verse or Bible version, Lord God and Jesus Christ. And since we're talking about the Old Testament, you're really going to look for God and Lord, because Jesus is not back there in the Old Testament. Now you got a problem. You begin to work up on some problems here if you're not really understanding how we're getting to this Passover event that many people deem is so vitally important and critical for your salvation. I'm going to look up the word reconcile and reconciliation in a dictionary. I had some thoughts and talked to a brother last night and kind of text him over my question about these two words. And I found it kind of interesting when I brought it up. And when we read the definitions of them, it's going to kind of take you in a Y pattern, two different ways you can look at the word reconcile or reconciliation. And I thought it, and I had never seen it before. I want to bring it up because we're dealing with something on this pattern or this chart about coming together. Because it's been said before by some of the brethren that this gospel by which we teach and by which we believe in is a gospel of reconciliation in order to reconcile or to come together in a understanding about something. But the question really is, how do you get reconciled? We know that we're listening to a gospel, and we're listening to what thus saith Yahshua the Messiah through a vessel. But then is there any act or any work to do? Right. That becomes your reconciliation. I done did something bad to you, and I'm trying to reconcile it and make it fair again, right? But then typically you got to do something. That's what I want to also include in why we have to be able to know where to begin when we begin to read this book and begin to learn something about your Creator, which is the archetype and original pattern of the universe by which everything follows. And when we start off right, we might be able to keep up with what's going on rather than trying to jump in the middle of an event you don't know nothing about. This Passover, I'm speaking specifically to those who don't understand the name, those who don't know where to begin. We have to learn these things in order to have a surefire gospel and be able to realize something. And that's that you're not going to be doing this. You're not going to be reconciling yourself unto anything. You're not going to be able to fix yourself.
Right.
I have to have the word reconcile first.
To restore to union and friendship after estrangement or variance.
To restore unto friendship, unto unity of a strange thing that has happened or an event that has happened. There's an event going on down here. You got these people coming up out of Egypt 430 years later. What was that event? What was the event? People want to jump in and start reading any old place they want to read in that book, and you best not jump over to the so-called New Testament, because then it don't have nothing to do by itself. It's all predicated on what's done happened in your Old Testament. And so when we're coming here and look at this 12th chapter, we got to know what we're dealing with and what they're being saved from. It's the same thing we're being saved from if we can see it in principle. And again, in this school, we go by analogies. We speak in metaphors. What is it? Analogies, metaphors, similes, and allegorical things. This is how we speak. This becomes a jargon once we understand what we're talking about. So when I say these people are being saved from something down here, we're being saved from the same thing, but what is it? Do we do what these people do down here, like it was read in the scripture reading today? Do we go get a lamb from the lambs or do an owl of the goats? Anybody got goats out in the property? Samuel might got a few. You got some ghosts to burn. But it says that each person, each house supposed to go get their own lamp.
I
got
three.
He got three. So we each supposed to get a lamb. And I know you can't eat all three, so you can share a little bit. But man, this is just here in Ontario. What are they going to do in Louisiana and down there where the flood Lord just went through? They ain't got nothing no more. Not even light. So Samuel's little three lambs ain't gonna help a whole lot of people if we're going to try to do this. Now, this is why I want reconciliation. And there's two versions to it.
Okay.
We're talking about a gospel by which we preach, and we have a gospel by which other people speak. Talking about the Catholicisms, the Christians, the Hindus, the Muslims, whatever other denomination you want to call it, this is another issue. Just read reconciliation, please.
Reconciliation.
Mm-hmm. There's two.
The action of reconciling, the state of being reconciled.
Okay, that's what we just read in reconcile. Todd just read it. To come back together again. Second one, Eunice.
The Roman Catholic sacrament.
We talking about a Roman Catholic. That's what I'm saying. I'm not dogging nobody. I'm just making a statement, referencing, letting you know that Roman Catholics has a definition for reconciliation. Now we got to understand when we read and talking to people, we want to reconcile. We want to unite together again, but is it going to be according to this Roman Catholic version? Is my point. And people thinking, because we've all been raised up some kind of way, one way or the other, whatever denomination, we all admit we came in to this school dead on arrival. Not understanding, being in ignorance.
Right.
That's all I mean by dead. I'm not putting nobody on 6 feet under. I'm talking about dead of ignorance. Again, we put by analogies, metaphors, similes. We got to understand, pick those things up if there's any first-time listeners. And so now we got a definition that we're talking about reconciliation, and it's talking about Roman Catholicism. And we're none of this because we're a school and not a church, remember? So there's going to be some there's not no unity here. In this definition, continue to read, please. Reconciliation.
Okay, it just says U.S. government, a legislative process.
No, go back up to two.
Two, same, that's all that it had, the Roman Catholics.
Give me another dictionary version of Roman Catholic. It's in there.
Yep, that's all that it had.
Webster, you know, we can use multiple books. We have books. This is what we work with, and we pull these messages out of this book. It's how we learn. It's how everybody's learned.
There's more under reconcile in my etymological dictionary that I like. It's also of God or Christ, restore mankind sinners to favor or grace.
Reconciliation, the second one, right. if you can find it. If not, I'll read mine. I mean, I read it last night.
Reconciliation from Google. Would you like that?
No. I want this. You read it off here to make sure we. No, I ain't trying to pull out no funny thing. The second one, and then I want you to hit the word penance. The second one.
Okay.
Which is. Basically what Eunice said, but that was more, but go ahead and read.
All right, the Roman Catholic Sacrament of Penance.
The Roman Catholic Sacrament of Penance. You hit penance, right?
Yeah.
And where does it go to?
An act of self-abasement.
An act of self-abasement, read.
Mortification.
Mortify yourself, read.
Or devotion performed to show sorrow or repentance for sin.
That's what I wanted to get out of that. And through reconciliation, the Roman Catholicism has one to have to do something. Mm-hmm. That's my point, is what I'm trying to pull out of there. And they use penance for a type of act in order to abase themselves, feel sorry for yourselves, for the sin that you think you've created. That's the point I was looking at last night, and how to convey it to somebody that don't know no better. And this is why we need to get Exodus, the third chapter. Let's go ahead and start at 1, since we're beginning from a start. And this is what I'm saying, that this sin, these carnal ordinances, is what the Roman Catholicisms are looking at. And there's some 613. Whether they acknowledge all of them anymore right now, I don't know. I'm not in that faith or denomination or understanding. But nonetheless, they're reading that Bible, which is the most world-renowned book, in order for someone to learn something about some God, which the Roman Catholicism do not specify a name for that God or their God or the Lord of theirs. But nonetheless, they'll read that book and they'll tell you, you best get circumcised. You best come to church and follow through our ceremonies and listen to one man preach. You best get dunked in some physical water. Remember, we just read the definitions, one definition for reconciliation unto the Roman Catholicism of what you need to do. And baptism is something a lot of denominations purport for one to have to do in order to come up off that sin of repentance. Passovers, hey, we read the whole 12th chapter of Exodus about a Passover. That was an ordinance. You see? That was something that people do. They get bunny rabbits and eggs. Whatever that has to do with anything, I don't know. Joe used to talk about that all the time. What do bunny rabbits and eggs have to do with the Passover? Yeah, we can break it down and get something out of the meaning of the rabbits and hares. That's fine. Nonetheless, it's a law. It was a law. We just read in there that they had to do it every year. Sacrifices? You don't see that going on too much anywhere. You know, more satanic, Lucifer type of people who have that entity want to purport as though they're doing some kind of bodily sacrifice. Look it up. Sometimes they make cakes that look like dead people. The superstars I'm talking about. Giving honor to that. Whole cakes, and you got hundreds of people around worshiping and sacrificing. So there are sacrifices still going on if you look deep into it enough. Typically, no, we don't have any lambs anymore. We're not bringing in billy goats anymore and turtle doves in here in order to have our sins forgiven with an innocent sacrifice. But that's another story. Hey, and then you got these Big Ten. Right? You got that Big Ten down here. Everybody know the Big Ten, which I doubt it. I don't even know all 10 of them, let alone the 603. You know, thou shalt not to take the Lord's thy God name in vain, which is already jacked up when you even make that statement. So you really don't know what it means. That's the darkness, that's the ignorance by which we want to eradicate and share and demonstrate to somebody that what you thought you knew, you don't really know. This is fact. Right. And when you come up off of it, all these acts of reconciliation according to the Roman Catholicism, because that's the harlot. That's the harlot we talk about. We talk about this Daniel chart. We've been over it. We understand pagan and papal and how pagan gave it up over to papal Rome. You have the Vatican City of Rome. You got the definition of reconciliation for souls. And they tell you, you got to do something. And we're saying there's nothing to physically do. It's by grace that the gospel is given unto us, whereby we can endure and live forever. If, as the scriptures read and read, we believe. But you can't believe if you don't know. Mm-hmm.
You can't love somebody if you don't know them. You can't commune with anybody if you don't know their name. It's called strangers in the book. The strangers weren't even allowed to eat the Passover. Why do you think that? Huh? They was with them, but they couldn't eat that Passover. So now you got this papal Rome that tell you about reconciliation, because remember, we've been taught that in Rome, it was a gathering of all of these Grecian disciplines and understandings of Greece. The cultural Greece was of the Medes and the Persians and Babylon. All the dynasties and the information, the way they did their, you know, the way they lived. And the sacrifices they sacrificed. Down in the, you got the Nimrod down here, the Tower of Babel, all the way back up in the great dynasties that we don't even, they're not even in your history book. But we understand that, but they are in that Bible. And we understand that all this is a conglomeration, is what I wanted to say. Until these 10 toes down here. And in this conglomeration of all these different acts and all these perversions of thought consummated here with the Romans. And from out of Rome, you get Christianity, all the various other type of denominations. Buddha and Islam and all that. Islam's new. Started some 600-700 years after the death of the Messiah. So that information, you know, we can get right back down on that, just as we can do any other things, because we got new denominations popping up all the time. But we want to go back to the root of it. Mm-hmm. And this is why I'm saying that root of it is telling a lot of people, they may not have read that and think they're doing anything wrong, but that's what it's conferring, that you have to do something. Now, what we say we have to do is come and listen, or listen on Zoom, or listen on YouTube, and pay attention. That's what we ask of you. That's a work in itself for a lot of people with ADD and can't sit still and can't find time for 2 hours and whatever other excuses. That's all that we ask for one to be able to come and do. Because when you do, you begin to learn about something. Exodus, the first chapter, please.
Exodus 1 and 1. Now these are the names of the children of Israel which came into Egypt. Every man in his household came with Jacob.
You said Exodus 1 and 1? I said 3 and 1. I'm sorry.
Now Moses kept the flock of Jethro.
I don't
want
to go that far back. Yeah. We're talking about Moses keeping a flock of sheep. Go ahead and read, brother.
His father-in-law, Jethro.
Jethro is his father-in-law.
The priest of Midian.
Now look, we're just starting right here. We're going to catch the thought of the beginning of what I've been taught and shown by our founder of where to start in the book. Do you know how Moses got out here on his backside with his sheep and his father Jethro and all that? We can pick all that up, but we want to get an important fact. Because in what I was talking about earlier, before we can love and become together, we got to know who one another is. I mean, really, if you got a mate or somebody, you have to have asked somebody their name. You know, I talked about a guy I was in the pool with the other night, and I asked him his name so we can have a better unity of connections for when we talked. We do that.
Right.
Shake hands, introduce yourself, just naturally. And we're talking about an introduction here. It's very important in order to begin to look at that Bible correctly. Read.
And he led the flock to the backside of the desert and came to the mountain of Elohim, even to Horeb.
Okay.
And the angel of Yahweh appeared unto him in a flame of fire out of the midst of a bush.
Now you got this bush that's burning, read.
And he looked, and behold,
Moses looked.
The bush burned with fire.
Moses is looking at the bush,
keep reading.
And behold, the bush burned with fire, and the bush was not consumed.
Meaning it wasn't falling, it wasn't turning into ash, it wasn't turning black, it wasn't falling down. But Moses is looking at the bush. Let's call this the bush. Right? And he's looking. It's still saying as a podium. Read.
And Moses said, I will now turn aside and see this great sight.
What did Moses turn aside to? What turned aside in Moses? Moses already looking at it, but now he's saying he's going to turn aside. Where is he turning aside? If he's turning any other way, he's not going to be looking at that bush, is my point. Thank you, sweetheart. You see? Read it, go back up to the last little verse. We saw Moses looking at this bush. There's an angel in this bush, and he's looking at this bush that's on fire, but not consumed, and?
And Moses said, I will now turn aside and see this great sight.
He said, I'm
going to
now turn around and see this great sight. That turning around was in his consciousness. It wasn't nothing physical that Moses had to do. He had to die, or he had to look at it honestly. Read.
Why the bush does not burn.
This is why, honestly, hey, I got it, in my consciousness, I want to know why this bush is not being consumed, and in my mind, he don't got a clue. Read.
And when Yahweh saw that he turned aside to see, Elohim called unto him out of the midst.
You got an angel, you got Elohim, and you got Yahweh calling from out of this bush that's not being consumed. It's in his consciousness. It's not a physical bush. It's in his. The bush is there, but what he's looking at is in his conscience. The bush is kind of like just vanished for a minute. It's just the burning and the fire, and those the Elohim and the Yahweh, the angels, those three, is in the bush, but it's in his consciousness. They're not physically out of the yucca bush. You got people trying to figure out what kind of bush it was. I mean, really, people trying to figure out what kind of bush is not consumed. In the real world, people look at and try to figure out what species of plant life this was. He making money on it if you can make it. All the fire that's going on in California, and you got a bush, you can sell a bush that does not burn, it's not consumed, you'll be all right. But we're talking about a consciousness. And it's in Moses' consciousness by which he turned around and looked, and he wanted to know why it was not consumed. That's Moses wanting to know something. That's for us to want to know how to be saved. What is this happening? Why is that happening? We want to have to know. And this is how we're going to be able to learn about knowing something. Read.
And when Yahweh saw that he turned aside to see, Elohim called to him out of the midst of the bush and said, Moses, Moses. Mm-hmm. And he said, here am I. And he said, draw not.
Hold on, read that. He said, who said, here am I? Go back up again.
No.
You right.
Elohim called unto him out of the midst of the bush and said, Moses, Moses. And he said, here am I.
Moses said, here I am.
Keep reading.
And he said, draw not nigh hither. Put off thy shoes from off thy feet, for the place whereon thou standest is holy ground. Moreover, he said, I am the Elohim of thy father, the Elohim of Abraham, the Elohim of Isaac, and the Elohim of Jacob.
That's good, because right now we're talking about an event. If you're looking at this chart for the first time, this is a mosaic chart. This is the second chart that was created after this elementary chart that was created. This chart is explaining the beginning of this third chapter in Exodus, about this burning bush. And we're reading, and we're going to find out something about this bush. We'll find out now this bush is in the holy place within the tabernacle pattern, which we understand the pattern as the moderator went through. He said it's consisted of three parts: a most holy place, a holy place, and a court roundabout. Now, we just read, He told Moses to take off his shoes because where he's standing on the backside in the wilderness of Mount Sinai or Mountain of Elohim, he's in the holy place. Okay? And he's about to be told something because he's been introduced because he turned aside within his consciousness. Now he's been introduced to these angels and what he's seeing and envisioning. Read.
And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look upon Elohim.
Mm-hmm.
And Yahweh said, I have surely seen the affliction of my people, which are in Egypt.
Now he's talking about some people. You see, now he's talking about some people that are Yahweh's people, that he chose to have something done to. And he's saying, he's seeing them, read.
And I have heard their cry by reason of their taskmasters.
By reason of their taskmasters, giving them more to do down here in Egypt is what he's talking to Moses about. Read.
For I know their sorrows.
They're sorrowful. They don't know why they're down there like that. Under persecutions of their taskmasters. And they're crying out like we're crying out sometimes. Yahweh, why are you making it so hard, man? Yahweh, why you do this? Why are you doing that? I want to know you, but man, you make it harder. Let me lose my job. Make my partner mad at me. Man, I'm trying. Read. That's what we feel like down here in Egypt when we're in darkness and don't know. Read.
And I am come down to deliver them.
Yahweh done come down.
Out of the hand of the Egyptians.
Out of the hands of the Egyptians. Now look. We got to understand Yahweh, when we read that statement, Yahweh done came down, we think he coming down physically.
Right.
Many people may take that interpretation because he said he's come down. And people not realizing what the unity of the Spirit is. I like to get 1 John, I think 5, 7, and 8. And then Deuteronomy 6 and 4. I get them twisted sometimes. Because right now, we remember there's three in this bush. So there was an angel, there was Elohim, and there was Yahweh. And now he just said, got done reading that Yahweh done came down. Now, we want to clarify this because it's important. It's called by the unity of the Spirit. And we're going to touch on it for a moment. Because we have the three names right here. Look, there was a spirit or an angel. There was Elohim and there was Yahweh that we just read about there at this burning bush. This is what we're working with. This is the unity of the Spirit. It's all one thing. Ayah, Asher, I. We're going to read this in a minute too. Because these three are one. Read 1 John.
1 John 5:7.
Yes.
For there are three that bear record in heaven.
We just talked about three. In heaven, we know the state of mind. And we understand that Moses turned in his consciousness to look at the book, to look at the bush, to ask why it was not burning. And he saw these three. Read.
The Father.
The Father.
The Word.
The Word. And or the Son.
And the Holy Spirit.
And the Holy Spirit.
And these three are one.
Yahweh ain't left nowhere. Because we understand if you listen to the moderation, and I like to get John 1 and 1 too. Let's continue on. You got Deuteronomy there? Just go ahead and grab Deuteronomy. It's talking about this oneness of the Spirit or the unity. Read.
Hear, O Israel.
Hear, O Israel. This is who he's saving. He's telling them, hear, O Israel. Hear this. Read.
Yahweh our Elohim is Yahweh a unity.
Is Yahweh a unity? A unity is one.
Right.
And what we come to learn in this school is that the one Spirit, which is Yahweh, is all that there is. He said that he chose the clouds because it symbolizes eternity, right? And this cloud goes all the way around this chart. And we know that everything abides in the realm of eternity. This is Yahweh. Yahweh is Spirit. Mm-hmm. You can't see Spirit. You can't touch Spirit. You can't hear Spirit. taste, or smell spirit. But now we also have this fiery cloud depicted on this chart. The dispensations and the ages start to give a little bit better clarity. Because some people might look at this, well, this is the eternity for Yahweh and just the Jews and the Israelite people alone. I don't see me on here nowhere. I see Moses and this, that story and the Egyptians, but where am I at? That's why I'll draw your attention over here to this chart, right, which is the ages and dispensations chart. Creation, the creation, where you live at today in 2020 is the creation, and it abides within Yahweh all eternity.
That's right.
Where you sit at right now, wherever that might be. Mm-hmm. So you understand what I'm saying, Don? All I'm saying, we understand that Yahweh, in the moderation, chose a cloud to symbolize himself, correct? And we see this cloud, or this cloud, a fiery cloud, goes all the way around this chart, right? Mm-hmm. And everything is abiding. But where are you at in this chart? That's why I'm making the reference.
Right.
Because I'm just now thinking, hey, where are we at in this chart? We're not seeing where we're at. And we understand that in this chart, there's a pattern going on. You understand that? Corral about, holy place, Canaan's land being the promised land, right? But it's dealing with the Jews only. And what I'm expressing to you is we're going to take this same fiery cloud, because this is within the realm of eternity that this is happening, because, you know, face it, we can't go get the ark, right? The Noah's ark. They try to find pieces of Noah's ark. You can't go find Noah's ark. You can't go find where Moses' sandals is at. You can't physically go get a lot of these things. Best thing you can touch is maybe the pyramids over there in Egypt. Everything else is a crapshoot based off, hey, they're still looking for the body of Yahshua the Messiah, the clothes of the shroud that he left here in his tomb, right? So this is I'm going to say, somewhat ambiguous to us. We believe it, but we don't have no hands on it. And all I'm saying, this fiery cloud is the same cloud that's on this chart. You see this orange around here? It's depicted as the fiery, same colors on that chart. And where you're at on this chart is right here in the sixth dispensation.
Mm-hmm.
You see me now? You're in the world, you work, we abide within Yahweh all eternity. We said that Yahweh came down. I'm saying Yahweh ain't come down from nowhere. John 1:1, and I'll be down.
Right.
Oh, follow me, that's Yahweh, right? And this is the dispensation. You got Adam and Eve, Noah, Melchizedek and Abraham, Moses. That's what's primarily on that chart, right? And then you got the death of the Messiah 2,000 years ago. And then now you got your fifth dispensation, your sixth dispensation, all working within Yahweh, which is pure spirit. Read John 1:1.
In the beginning,
Yahweh, read.
Was the Word. And the Word was with Yahweh.
The Word was with Yahweh.
And the Word was Yahweh.
This Word was Yahweh. Read.
The same was in the beginning with Yahweh.
We just read 1 John, they're all in unity. They're all one and the same. The Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit. These three are one. We're just trying to draw it out so one can see that this substance of spirit, you can't touch. You can't comprehend it. It's impossible. But he knew that, therefore he divested himself. Not in totality of spirit, but in part as known as Elohim. The Word or Son.
Mm-hmm.
This shape and form can only be seen in divine visions and revelations. In this shape and form. And what I'm saying came down, read to 14.
And the Word was made.
This word, what was it? What happened to it?
And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us.
Remember, not only here with this Yahshua the Messiah, but also back here with Yahshua Messiah. You understand that, right? That Yahshua was back here with Moses, his minister, Yahshua was Moses' minister. So you got Yahshua came down from Elohim, which was the first created, came down in a body,
and dwelt on this earth plane. Came down through Adam, came down through all these patriarchs as in spirit. This is what's come down. And when we read back there, Exodus, the third chapter, you don't have to get it, but we say Yahweh came down. Hey, this is Yahweh that come down in the body of Yahshua the Messiah in order to edify his people and to be able to bring his people up. It becomes a beautiful story if you understand the continuity of what's being expressed. Now, the bell has rung, and my time has expired. And I hope that someone received a little bit of encouragement or edification in what was said. We always try to do our best. Yeah.
Can I ask just one quick question?
Sure.
Okay, that son of Nun, could other people see him besides Moses? Or only Moses was able to see him? Like, eye to eye.
They saw him, but they didn't know who he was.
Right.
So you can't see him.
Huh?
So if we were there, we'd be able to see him.
Yeah, you have seen the son of Nun, but you didn't know who he is. Some schmuck that came in right. From Ephraim's clan,
okay.
Right? He just from Ephraim, one of Ephraim's clan family member. I don't know. You don't know every family member of every tribe.
Right.
You know, he wasn't standing heads of boulders, shoulders above himself. You know, not like the first Saul that we read about here, the first king of Israel that was a big guy. That they wanted him as a king, but down here he wasn't king like that, but he was Moses' minister. And one more peep before I leave, you see this, Yahshua was already down here some 30 years after Moses done left up out of here into this wilderness. And it is this Yahshua that's projecting himself at this burning bush unto Moses. Just let that be sink in for a minute and come back and hear. How is it that Yahshua, astral projected, that son of Nun, astral projecting and showing himself to Moses in a vision in a burning bush,
mm-hmm.
calling himself I Asher I,
right.
I will be what I will to be.
Right.
I will to be the chair, I will to be the bird, I will to be you.
Mm-hmm.
Okay,
yes.
Like Christian thought, okay. Like they think he's coming down.
Yes, ma'am.
Like the sky's gonna rip open.
Yes.
Here he comes, but that's not so. But I'm kind of believing he never left.
Yeah.
Okay.
You feel me?
I feel you. Hold that thought. Keep that thought. And the next speaker can come and handle that and work on whatever is in that vessel to say. But other than that, I enjoyed your attention and I appreciate your questions. And I'll yield the floor to the next speaker.
Hallelujah.
Thank you for that, Dr. Marlon Love. For our next speaker for today's class, I would like to call the president of the Ontario branch, Dr. Christopher Williams. Dr. Williams?
Good morning, class.
Good morning.
As always, it's a pleasure and honor to be able to stand before you, the Assembly of Yahshua Messiah, to bestow upon you some of the things I've come to know and learn in this class since I've been in here. And I appreciate the first speaker. And I keep forgetting to bring that other what you call it, but as soon as I can, take care of it. I can. Right back where we started. I'm going to do my best to continue in the same vein, and I'm going to address your question, because at first I'm like, is this mother? Oh, okay, never mind. We're good. He spoke over here, and if he didn't explain it, you'd be like, what the heck's he talking about? But he was being language and analogies to explain this concept. Or to convey this thought is what he's trying to do. And sometimes analogies need to come from different angles, and you don't see that. So I'm going to do my best to try to say what he said and present it in a way that makes more sense to you.
Okay.
Because At first, I too was like, what is he talking about? But when I heard him speak, I'm like, okay, he just went a different direction than what I'm used to. Because we're saying the same, we're going to say the same thing, but the way he went about it is different. Now, I'll say this. The great thing about this gospel is that when you put it on the pattern, all things are reconciled, right? And when you deal with Yahweh, no matter who's on the floor or what's presented, the truth always speaks for itself.
That's right.
Okay? And I think you did a really good job with this because the way you presented it made me think differently about certain other things in that moment. But let me try to pick that up. So get Exodus 3 and 1, and we'll see what we can do with this and then go from there. Because I had a whole totally different direction I was going to go in, and then he brought this up. I'm like, well, that changed that. Thanks once again. Now, I don't know about all that. Shucks. In fact, but I'm glad you took as long as you did. I don't have to be up here too long. It made your life difficult. It's simpler for me. Whenever you're ready.
All right. Now Moses kept the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian.
Now this is what we have pictorially illustrated down here. Read.
And he led the flock to the backside of the desert and came to the mountain of Elohim, even to Horeb.
Read.
And the angel of Yahweh appeared unto him in a flame of fire out of the midst of a bush.
Now, like he said, this was a vision. This was not physically happening. Keep in mind, we got dry brush in the desert. And if it's on fire, the whole thing is going up. Okay? But that's not what's happening. This one bush is burning. So that's how you know it's a vision. Read.
And he looked, and behold, the bush burned with fire, and the bush was not consumed.
Read.
And Moses said, I will now turn aside and see this great sight, why the bush does not burn.
Read.
And when Yahweh saw that he turned aside to see, Elohim called unto him out of the midst of the bush.
Now,
and
when
said
he turned aside to see, all that's saying is he caught his attention. So now he's engaging with Moses. Because now Moses is engaged with this burning bush. Okay? So now he can connect with him. He can convey a thought, lay some understanding on him, and go from there. Read.
And he said, Moses, Moses. And he said, here am I.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, draw not nigh hither. Mm-hmm. Put off thy shoes from off thy feet, for the place whereon thou standest is holy ground.
So he's saying a whole lot there. So he calls Moses by name, identifying that, hey, I know who you are. I'm about to introduce myself to you. And he's saying, take your shoes from off thy feet, for the place where I now stand is this holy ground. Now, is it holy ground because of this burning bush?
No.
It's holy ground because this is the holy place in the pattern. Now he's saying, let me take your shoes off so I can connect with your soul. The soul of your foot is going to help me talk to you right now. Read. You understand?
Moreover, he said, I am the Elohim of thy father, the Elohim of Abraham, the Elohim of Isaac, and the Elohim of Jacob.
So now he's naming all these patriarchs to identify that, hey, I communicated with these folks as well as I'm communicating with you. He's qualifying himself, basically. Read.
And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look upon Elohim. And Yahweh said, I have surely seen the affliction of my people, which are in Egypt, and have heard their cry by reason of their taskmasters, for I know their sorrows.
So now he's saying, I've heard their cry. Now, Christians would believe, or would have you believe, that he is physically listening to this event that's happening, and that he's in heaven somewhere above the sun, moon, and stars and has an earpiece or some kind of like camera located throughout the earth and he's listening to these cries. No, that's not what's happening because he's going to be real specific. Read.
And I am come down to deliver them out of the out of the hand of the Egyptians.
Now, for years, and I don't mean like one, two, or three. I mean like a couple decades I read that and never understood what the heck that was talking about. When he said, I have come down to deliver them out of the hands of Egypt. So at the time, and if you pay attention to what I was saying, Yahshua, the son of Nun, was already down here. So this wasn't something that was going to happen. This is something that had already begun. Yahshua was down here after Moses fled from Egypt, was down here with the Egyptians suffering right along with them. So he experienced the oppression. He was down here being beaten just like everybody else. So he was experiencing. That's why he said, I know their sorrows.
Right.
To know something is to experience it. Yeah, so it wasn't like somebody was just going through the motions here. It wasn't like he heard it through the grapevine.
Yeah.
He was right there with them, suffering right along with them. Got it?
Yeah.
Okay. Now, keep in mind, we're dealing with Yahweh. We're not dealing with some guy off the streets, somebody who don't know what he's doing. We're dealing with the creator of everything that you see and that you don't see. And everything that Yahweh does, he does with strategically. Everything is happening according to a purpose mm-hmm. that was set up right here in the beginning. Okay? Read.
And to bring them up out of the land unto a good land, and a large, unto a land flowing with milk and honey.
Now, when he said, now let me back it up. So now he said, I am come down to deliver them out of the hands of Egypt. So, Marlon talked to you about the unity of the Spirit. Mm-hmm. Yahweh, Elohim, Yahshua, these three are one, right? And then we showed you, because of Romans 1:19 and 20, Yahweh uses something physical to explain something spiritual. Because Yahweh is spirit. John 4:24, real quick. Anybody can get it.
For Elohim is.
No, not anybody, but, you know.
John.
You gotta use your
word. You ready?
Any day now.
John 4:24.
Yeah.
For Yahweh is spirit.
Uh-huh.
And they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth.
All right. So Yahweh is spirit. Now, he's not a spirit. He is the spirit of all spirit, right? The sum total of everything you see and that you don't see, right?
Amen.
Okay. You're killing me, Mom. You're killing me.
I'm telling you how it is. Take it or leave it.
All right. So, according, so in the Bible, they use the spirit, the water, and the blood to show that these three agree in one. To prove the unity of the spirit. Because if you have spirit in your body, you have blood and you have water, and without those things, this one body, this one unit cannot function, showing the unity of the spirit. Now, I'm going to take water to prove the unity of the spirit. Okay? Now, no matter what, When Yahweh created a creation, and we have it pictorially illustrated here, the creation is this. Couple blank stares, right? Because what I'm trying to get you to see is, you know what? Here, I need a better picture of it. That way you can understand it. Now, this is something Joe Williams loved to do. I don't know why. He thought this was the best thing since sliced bread.
Okay.
To prove this one point, he enjoyed doing this. It used to drive me up a wall because we do this all the time. We talk about it all the time, and I couldn't understand how come people don't get this. And after I thought about it, it makes sense because it's actually very profound, this concept, right? So, my dad's number one catchphrase was this: you are what you've been looking for.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Now, to someone, it sounds very inspirational. but in principle, it means you are nothing more than Yahweh in a body.
Right.
The only thing that's wrong with you is that you are not conscious of it because you think there's a you and a Yahweh.
Right.
Right. Right. That's your carnality. Don't take it personal. We all had our day in the sun. And guess what? Even those who think they aren't, are. Because carnality is a human condition that has been imposed on us on purpose so that we would have to have trials and tribulations. If we had zero carnality, then everything would just make sense and we would have zero issue. But then there'd be no need for a savior.
That's right.
So, because Yahweh is a jealous Yahweh, and he wants to make sure that he gets all the glory, he did exactly just that. He created carnality for you and put it in you so that you would have to struggle with the idea of who he is. So he hid himself from himself to present himself to himself. Meaning, you are what you've been looking for, and you didn't know it. And how I'm going to prove that is this. Now, this is Yahweh. This is pure spirit, right? Okay? So these are the. This is spirit, and I'm given to you in a pictorial illustration. So basically, spirit is nothing more than intelligent, divine intelligence, wisdom and knowledge, beauty, love and justice, foundation, power and strength. That is what spirit is. That's not what spirit. It's not something that you can see with your eyes. You can't smell it. You can't touch it. You just have to see the manifestation of it. And we talk about this all the time. The manifestation of love is the same you have with your parent, with your kids, and a parent and a kid. They love their baby. They raise their baby. They struggle and sacrifice for their kid as they get older. They become adults, and then you want to kill them.
Yeah.
I'm getting a little too personal. But the point is, you can see the love based on the manifestation of it. The love is represented through the manifestation of my work, what I do. You can tell when someone's intelligent by the way they speak, the way they carry themselves, and how they present that same information to you. You can recognize, oh, that guy's really intelligent. And you can definitely tell when someone's an idiot, right?
Amen.
That's hard. It's hard. Stop correcting yourself. It is what it is. Damn Christians. Anyhow. At any rate, so you have spirit. And he talked about how Yahweh is not a cloud, but he chose a cloud because it has no particular scripture, shape, or form showing that spirit is that way. So Yahweh is not, so spirit is not a cloud. We don't know what spirit looks like. All we can see is that spirit materialize. You are spirit materialize. This chair is spirit materialize. The air, which you can't see, is spirit materialized. But spirit is everywhere and encompasses everything. It is incomprehensible and inscrutable. You can't see it, but we know it's there. However, because of that, because Yahweh loved us, he said, let me give them something they can see. And so he transformed or transmuted in part, not all of the spirit that took to create this creation and took on a shape and form as Elohim. This and this are the same thing.
Right.
Now, in order for you to understand what this is, he showed you this. But Dr. Kinley said, I want to explain this in detail. And so he painted this chart. Mm-hmm. This is no more than the heart opened up for you. So you can see that in operation, universal spirit law, which is the same thing as this, is in operation. And that's what's running the show. So when he said he came down, he created a creation, and that was a divestation or a death from a high and lofty state to a lesser state, meaning you can see it in visions and in dreams, but it's still inscrutable unless he chooses to reveal himself to you. So you ever, when you were a kid and you were learning math for the first time, remember? And you first discover 1 + 1 = 2 and you can see in your head, that was Yahweh revealing himself to you in the form of math. When you first found out that you could read C-A-T means cat, that was Yahweh revealing himself for the first time in language. Every time you discover something, every time you learn something, that is Yahweh communicating with you for the first time on that thought. And every thought that you've had since you've been on this earth is Yahweh communicating with you through the Spirit, because that's how he touches a man. Do you understand what I'm saying? So, when he did this and showed you this, that was the creation in and of itself. Let me prove that. 24, 9, and 10. Exodus, sorry.
Exodus 24,
Exodus 24:9-10.
Mm-hmm.
Then went up Moses and Aaron, Nadab and Abihu, uh-huh. and 70 of the elders of Israel.
Uh-huh.
And they saw the Elohim of Israel.
Uh-huh.
And there was under his feet,
uh-huh.
as it were, a paved work of a sapphire stone.
Now this, what we have illustrated here, is Yahweh Elohim standing on the earth.
Mm-hmm.
This is the universe, and this is just a portion of it that we drew out in the Bible so you can see Yahweh standing on the earth, the creation, that you know it. Because last time I checked, none of us has been to another planet.
Right.
And we can talk about, we can show you our imagination of flying through the cosmos. So as I know, no one's been there. So this is the creation as we know it. Make sense? Okay. So, when he created this creation and he put man on the earth, that was him coming down in the flesh, mm-hmm. as man. Not from some geological location, but from one state and condition to another. So when he said, I am come down to deliver them out of the hands of Egypt, that was him saying, well, I've manifested myself on the earth as Yahshua, the son of Nun, or as people call him Joshua, the son of Nun, to execute my purpose and my plan so that this thing that I've started can finish. Mm-hmm. Now, the great thing about Yahweh is that he doesn't send anyone else to go do his thing.
Right.
Now, Marlon first started off saying he does everything through a man. But it's not the man in of itself that is doing the work. It is the Holy Spirit in that man.
Right.
And when you understand who the Holy Spirit is, because now we got to do this. Jeez Louise. Right? Now, we want to understand the unity of the Spirit in and of itself so that it makes sense, no matter what is said. So, Yahweh is the Father. Elohim is the Word or Son. Now, somebody might say, what in the, how's Elohim the Son? I'm confused. I thought Yahshua was the Son. What are we doing here? Right? And then, now we got Yahshua as the Holy Spirit. I'm so confused. I don't get what's going on here. You know, can someone explain this to me? Wait.
Yep.
Raise your hand if you're slightly confused, but you know. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. One honest person in the room. Everybody's confused, but yet they know. So, I don't think anyone has a problem with the Father, correct?
Correct.
Well, we're on the same page, like, yeah, we know what the Father is. And then when we get to the Holy, to the Word or Son, we're like, yeah, somebody's got to explain this to me. But yeah, we're going to stick with it. It's like the Republicans in Trump right now. We're gonna roll with this. We think he's doing what we need him to do, but we don't, man, just shut up and go, right?
Yeah.
We don't want to get in trouble. So let me explain this to you. Now, this is the Word. This is the Son. But yet, they're the same people.
Right.
Now, when, let me see if I understand this. Let me see if I can do this. I am the CEO of CW Convenient Couriers. But I'm also the general manager of CW Convenient Couriers. I'm the same guy.
Right.
I have two different hats. Now, the great thing about me is when I don't want to be bothered, I'm the CEO. Y'all hear that? But when I need to be bothered and I got to get in the weeds, I'm like, oh, God, yeah, I'm the GM. Let me get in there and start whipping some, you know. But yet, I'm doing the same thing.
Right.
Now, when Yahweh was on, when Yahshua the Messiah was on the earth and he was praying to Yahweh Elohim, Yahweh, he was praying to this one here, to himself, in principle, for a point. But when he was, where's that? Give me Plant 32 is fine. Plant 32 is fine. Any one of those works. Oh, sorry. But when he's ascended in heaven, he's the Son. No different. It's a round trip. He's Yahweh, Elohim, and he's the Son at the same time. Interchangeable, because it's for the purpose. Kind of like in the Bible when you read Elohim, and then you got Yahweh, and then you got Yahweh Elohim, you got to know when to use the right one versus the other. And he is always, Yahshua is always the Holy Spirit, because that it is what is going to save us. Do you understand? So that's how we reconcile Yahweh Elohim and Yahshua in their roles. It's just a role. Okay, the union of the Spirit is that. Now, I use water as an example, physically, so that so we understand how this union of the Spirit is working. Now, when water, when H2O is a gas, is it not still H2O? When H2O is in a liquid state, meaning it is takes on the shape or form, whatever it's in, is it still not H2O? Yeah. And when it's a solid or ice, is it still H2O? Correct. That is how we reconcile the unity of the Spirit. So you understand physically how Yahweh is capable of doing that. He didn't have to explain that to you, but because he loved the world, he gave you some damn understanding. And that is one more time Yahweh communicating with you through the Spirit. Right. I literally can't make this stuff up. I'd like to. Then I'd sound like I'm really intelligent. I'm just regurgitating what I just read. Okay? Does that answer your question? All right, we're on the same page. Whew, that's first. Anyhow, now I got it. All right, so how much time I got? I got a few minutes. All right, I don't lead this anymore. No, I got it. Yes, ma'am.
Marlon was going to break something down with that ayah, Asher ayah. Could you break that down?
I just did.
I will be able to what I will to be.
The 3-in-1,
the unity.
Yeah. I am Yahweh, pure spirit, and I will to be the creation, and so I took on shape or form. That is, I will be what I will to be.
So that's what that the 3 means.
That means I will be what I will to be. Asher. Aya, Asher, Aya.
I will be pure spirit, I will be super incorporeal, and I will be in the flesh, manifest in the flesh.
Yahweh's name means he who brings into existence whatever exists. So, if it exists, it exists by the will of Yahweh. So if you notice, that word Ayah has I will be in it. That's what it means. I literally can't make this up. Like, it does all the explaining for me. It's beautiful. I love it. Does that make sense?
I get it now.
Okay. If you don't, tap me on the shoulder. We'll do it again. Okay. All right, so the scripture lesson is what I was going to get into. Because this is a school, and we want to make sure we stay on the curriculum, and the curriculum is Elohim, the archetype original pattern of the universe, and I'd like to further draw that out because I think it's important. So if you can get me plate 31. I should have just got that in the first place. I could have killed two birds with one stone. Thank you, sir. All right. Yeah, we can do this here. Or should I do it over there? Yeah, I'll do it over here. Yeah, we don't know. We don't need Noah. He's not that important. Anyhow. Yeah, you're right. All right. So we were talking about Moses and how he started this whole thing at the burning bush, right? And as we further go through that story, we actually see Moses as he's battling with Pharaoh. So that, because for the sake of time, I don't want to go round and round about what the story I think everyone in here knows. And if you don't know the story, I can go through it. Just raise your hand. All right, good. Just want to make sure we're on the same page. I don't want to leave anyone behind. Now, we got the Israelites on the first day of the month. It's going to be a new month to them, or the first month to them, to do what? The Passover. Now, this is big. It's one of the biggest Jewish holidays of the bunch. We love this one because we get to eat, right? And everybody love to eat. I don't know about y'all. There's something about, you know, that those bitter herbs that just make me get excited, right? And I don't know about unleavened bread, but it is what it is. I guess I like flat bread. However, so let's get into this and see how this fits the curriculum of Elohim, the archetype original pattern of the universe, because the pattern is what we're here for, right? Because if you understand this pattern, then you understand how to unlock all the mysteries of the universe, and it'll just make your life that much more simpler. Now, when I say simple, it means it ain't gonna like get easy, ain't like an easy button, but at least you're like, oh, that's why my life is going right here. I'm at this stage of the pattern. That's all it's for. It's just a guide. You still gotta live your life, you still gotta get your butt kicked, and you still gotta fight and figure out how to win. That is life. So if you think that coming to class and learning about Yahweh is gonna make your life easier, it actually makes it harder. Because now you know the horrors that are standing in front of you. That's crazy. I'm under the auspices. I would rather see my trouble coming than it sneak up on me. Right. Like, I will never understand for the life of me why anyone... Actually, I take that back. Let me rephrase this. I like to see that coming, but I like to see my stuff coming unless it's a natural disaster. If it's a natural disaster, sneak up on me. Right. Surprise the heck out of me. Because I do not want to see that horror. Have you ever seen a tornado in your life? Neither have I. I don't want one. I mean, I've seen Twister. That was terrible. I mean, them hurricanes and what they do. I've seen video of hurricanes turn into tsunamis and tsunamis come. Oh, no. That's horrific. But earthquakes, I can live with that. Shake, rattle, and roll, and as long as I don't see that coming, it is what it is. And if you get me, by then, it's done deal. Yeah, you can shake me all day. Yeah, I just turn into a dance. Anyhow, let me get into this thing. Okay, so now, get the 12th chapter if you haven't got it already. So let's start reading.
And Yahweh spake unto Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, saying, this month shall be unto you the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year to you.
This is April, Abib, okay, if you didn't know. You want, just read it. What is it, 13th chapter? 13:6? Read 13:6.
Exodus 13:6. 7 days thou shalt eat unleavened bread.
No. What is it? Was it 13:4?
Oh, Abib?
Yeah.
This day came ye out in the month Abib.
Is that it?
And it shall be when Yahweh shall bring thee into the land.
What's the third verse?
And Moses said unto the people, remember this day in which ye came out from Egypt, out of the house of bondage. For by strength of hand, Yahweh brought you out from this place. There shall no leavened bread be eaten.
Am I speaking Swahili? Maybe I have a problem.
I think you started.
This day came out.
Okay.
But it's going to be the first month to you is what you're looking for, right?
No, I'm tripping. It's fine. We got it. It's Abib. It's April. I got it. I got that part.
34:18.
Huh?
34:18 has been there. For in the month of Abib, thou camest out from Egypt.
Okay, we're good. Congratulations, we got there. We're right. Go back to 12.
12?
12 and 2. This month shall be unto you the beginning of months. Mm-hmm. It shall be the first month of the year to you.
Mm-hmm.
Speak ye unto all the congregation of Israel, saying, in the 10th day of this month shall they take to them every man a lamb, according to the house of their fathers, a lamb for a house.
All right. So it says, speak ye to all the congregation of Israel. So everyone that's going to partake in this whole Passover was half of the Israelites, right? Correct?
No.
It's going to be half of the Israelites, right?
No.
So all of the congregation of Israel is going to do this. Mm-hmm. Now, Why is that? Is it because this is the only way all of them can be saved? Is that the whole message? Right. So it seems that way. So if we're taking it literal, yes, that's the only way they're going to get through this. However, there is an operation or a purpose and a plan that's in operation, right? And Yahweh is setting something up here. This is a foreshadowing of events, because whatever happens to Moses is going to be confirmed or fulfilled by Yahshua himself. Mm-hmm. So that's why we have plate 31 here, to show how this is going to be a fulfillment of what was happening, what's going to happen to the Messiah. Now, keep reading.
And if the household be too little for the land, let him and his house take it according to the number of souls.
Uh-huh.
Every man according to his eating shall make your count for the lamb.
Read.
Your lamb shall be without blemish, a male of the first year.
Mm-hmm.
Ye shall take it out from the sheep or from the goats.
Now, it's talking about the lamb. Now, Yahweh said he is the lamb slain from the foundation of the earth. So we are talking about Yahshua the Messiah with these Israelites. But they didn't know that. Because guess what? They're eating unleavened bread for a reason. They're not supposed to see the leaven yet, because they ain't risen. Right?
Mm-hmm.
So we're talking about a foreshadowing of events. And this is going according to a pattern.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So this lamb was without spot and was without blemish. He was the first lamb of the year to them. Right? He's their first son. Read.
And ye shall keep it until the 14th day of the same month, and the whole assembly of the congregation of Israel shall kill it between the two evenings.
So now we have this lamb that they're going to get on the 10th and hold it over until the 14th day. And they're going to kill it between the two evenings. Call me crazy, but didn't they have him out here? They got him. They persecuted him. They beat him. And this went on for a few days, did it not? And then on the last day, they killed him between the two evenings.
Mm-hmm.
Did they not?
Yeah.
But we're talking about a lamb, right? Read.
And they shall take of the blood and strike it on the two side posts.
All right, hold on. So we took the blood, nailed it in one hand, put them over here, nailed them in another hand. Is that blood coming? What is that? Is that? Okay, just want to make sure we're on the same page. And then?
And on the upper doorposts of the house.
Oh, wait. So then they put a crown of thorns, and what is that red stuff coming from his head right there? Can anybody see that? Blood, right? All right, read.
Wherein they shall eat it,
mm-hmm.
and they shall eat the flesh in the night, roast with fire and unleavened bread,
mm-hmm.
and with bitter herbs shall they eat it.
Now, when they took that blood, they dipped it, they put on a two-side post and dipped it from a basin, showing 4 points of blood, right? And they nailed him in his feet. Now, we're talking about the eating of this lamb. Now, read that again. What you just read.
And they shall eat the flesh in the night, mm-hmm. roast with fire mm-hmm. and unleavened bread, mm-hmm. and with bitter herbs shall they eat it.
Read.
Eat not of it raw, mm-hmm. nor boiled at all with water,
mm-hmm.
but roast with fire,
mm-hmm.
his head with his legs, mm-hmm. and with the inwards thereof.
So they ate all of that lamb, right? And they killed this man, right?
Mm-hmm.
So they killed the lamb, and when that lamb was done being eaten, it was gone. He talked about it. They were looking for the robes. They found nothing in that tomb when he was there, right?
Mm-hmm.
Zero. And they said, if there's anything left, they said, burn it. Because when they found this lamb, what was left? Nothing. So they had to consume all of that lamb.
Mm-hmm.
Read.
And ye shall let nothing of it remain until the morning.
Read.
And that which remaineth of it until the morning, ye shall burn with fire.
Read.
And thus shall ye eat it, with your loins girded, mm-hmm. your shoes on your feet, and your staff in your hand.
Now, the reason for that is that they were getting ready to come out this thing. We don't have a picture to illustrate very well. But when they came out five abreast, and it was like an army marching out of Egypt through the Red Sea. Now, call me crazy, but when he rose, because this was a resurrection out of Egypt, right?
Mm-hmm.
That's why they call it the Exodus out of Egypt. They were resurrecting out of Egypt, to get to the to the holy place, right? Well, when he resurrected, wasn't there sons that resurrected with him? And it looked like, and if, look how that picture totally illustrated. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Five breaths walking on out of that place, right? And you saw Adam, you saw Noah, you saw Moses, Samuel, you saw them all just walking like, hey, how you guys doing? You know? Just how they walked out of there. No different. According to a purpose. This was predestinated back here with the Lamb that was slain from the foundation of the world, of the universe. And then he went down and just executed that plan. That's beautiful. I don't know anybody can do that. I wish I could. Man, I'd be rich. Anyhow, moving on. Read.
And ye shall eat it in haste. It is Yahweh's Passover.
Mm-hmm.
For I will pass through the land of Egypt this night, and will smite all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, both man and beast, and against all the deities of Egypt. I will execute judgment. I am Yahweh. And the blood shall be to you a token upon the houses where ye are.
Read.
And when I see the blood, I will pass over you. And the plague shall not be upon you to destroy you.
And that's why they call it the Passover Supper. Or the Passover. Because, well, we like Samuel. We're going to pass over him. But we don't like this hat. We're going to get him. That's basically what it was. Okay? So Egyptians didn't have any blood in their head. And so they all going to suffer from this one. Right? And it's, yes.
Can you go back to the middle chart again?
What, this one right here?
Yeah.
Okay.
It's like, did they really just come out of the grave like that and went somewhere?
Okay. So, remember, when we were at the burning bush, was this an actual burning bush?
No.
Or was it a vision of a burning bush?
Vision.
Okay. Now, when he resurrected a quickening spirit. Now, shucks. Can somebody give me the Bible? Is this a holy name? Holy name. There you go. So, I believe it is Ecclesiastes. I could be wrong. Now, this was prophesied about how he was going to be resurrected with sinews. Can you look it up? Look up sinews in the Bible and tell me where it's at.
It's not Ezekiel?
No, it's not Ezekiel. Do you know what it, you found it? You know what it's at?
I don't see Ecclesiastes.
No, it's not Ecclesiastes. Excuse
okay,
me.
Let's look at Isaiah.
It's not Isaiah.
Yeah. Let me check Isaiah 48.
No.
No?
No. Modern technology. Gotta love it.
S-I-N-E-W-S.
Gosh darn it. Come on now.
Ezekiel.
Okay, read it.
And I will lay sinews upon you, and will bring up flesh upon you, and cover you with skin, put breath in you, and ye shall live, and ye shall know that I am Yahweh.
That was it. So when he rose up a quickening spirit, because it says flesh and blood cannot enter into the kingdom. There was no blood in his body when he rose. But he just read about a prophesy in Ezekiel, and it was Ezekiel, how that he's gonna lay sinews upon him, and sinews are nothing more than the ligaments and things that are make up our body, hold the muscles and all that in together, so that this body can walk, because he can't move a body without no muscles. So he's got muscles, the whole nine yards, but there's no blood in his body. No, he's not flesh and blood. He said blood can't enter the kingdom with, basically, you got to be dead. Okay? And so this was a quickening spirit that rose up and sojourned on the earth for 40 days, tarried on the earth for 40 days. But the sons that rose up with him, when they saw it, was a vision. When they were down here and it was a cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night, that was a vision. No one else saw that but them. Their minds were illuminated so that they can get through their nights. In principle, because there always had to be light in the tabernacle. And so they never were without the light. Because he said, I am the light of the world. Mm-hmm. And so he lit their nights for them. In principle. So when he rose, up a quickening spirit, and the sons of Elohim rose up with him, but that was a vision for them to see. Does that make sense?
Ezekiel 26, 37 and 6. And I will lay sinews upon you, and I will bring up flesh upon you, and cover you with skin, and put breath in you, and ye shall live, and ye shall know that I am Yahweh.
No bones. I was thinking bones, not blood, but flesh and just flesh.
Mm-hmm.
No bones.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, this is the fourth verse. You want it?
What is it?
Ezekiel 37:4. Again, he said unto me, prophesy upon these bones, and say unto them, O ye dry bones, hear the word of Yahweh.
Mm-hmm.
Thus saith Yahweh unto these bones, behold, I will cause breath to enter into you, and ye shall live.
Mm-hmm.
So they do speak of bones there. And then it continues into the 6. And I will lay sinews upon you, and bring up flesh upon you, and cover you with skin, and put breath in you, and ye shall live, and ye shall know that I am Yahweh.
And that's how we have that. That makes sense. So the point I was making is that as the tabernacle or the pattern goes, so does the story of the Passover, as is the death, burial, and resurrection and ascension of Yahshua the Messiah. Everything is happening according to a pattern, and nothing is happening haphazardly through the earth. So as you look at things that are going on then and going on now, everything is happening according to a pattern. And while everyone's getting up and arms, like, oh, the end times. Like, listen, we've had the same end times for the last, I don't know how many eons. Okay, so I'm going to say this. I think we read it. I was reading it in, real quick, and I'll sit down. Acts 1 and 9. No, 1 and 7.
Acts 1 and 7. And he said unto them, it is not for you to know.
Oh, go to 1 and 6. 1 and 6.
1 and 6. When they therefore were come together, they asked of him, saying, Rabbi, wilt thou at this time restore again the kingdom to Israel? And he said unto them, it is not for you to know the times or the seasons which the Father hath put in his own power.
Mm.
But ye shall receive power after the Holy Spirit is come upon you.
Mm-hmm.
And ye shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria, mm-hmm, and unto the uttermost part of the earth.
So the point is this. Don't worry about what you don't need to worry about. Seek ye the Holy Spirit, and all things will be reconciled to Yahshua the Messiah. And with that, I'd like to say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Dr. Christopher Williams. That will conclude today's lecture. Are there any announcements for today? Do we have any announcements? Okay. We hold classes here at 1816 East Elma Court in Ontario, California, on Tuesdays and Thursdays from 7:30 p.m. to 9:30 p.m., and on Sundays from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. Please bring all your friends and your enemies, because this is truly the place to be. All donations can be accepted by our treasurer, Dr. Eunice Reiser. And let us all stand to be dismissed with a doxology taken from Jude, the 24th and the 25th chapter. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise Elohim, our Savior, through Yahshua the Messiah, our Sovereign, belong glory and majesty, dominion and power before all time, now and ever. Let us all say, Hallelujah. Hallelujah.